and welcome. My name's Jacqueline Inda, and I'm running for District 1, which is the Eastside District. I'm running because I'm the only local viable person running within the district. I was born and raised there, and I've done a lot for the community at large as well. I've created different programs that have helped with suicides, with education, with getting our kids into college, and getting our kids prepared for doing something better within our communities. This is the reason why I participated with district elections. I participated with this so that our youth and our future generations have the ability to grow up in their neighborhoods, to do positive things within them, and one day actually get a chance to run and effectively get into office. This is the future for our city, and I'm glad that I participated in that. I'm also honored to have been participant of many other things that could have changed the very fabric of our communities. Things like the gang injunction, things like creating Santa Barbara Trauma Response Network so that people could go in and get psychological first aid, participating with the American Red Cross when we had to clear out the floods in 1995 and 1998, and creating disaster preparedness teams so that they can go out and respond to the community. Those are all things that I've done. Why am I running for office? Because I want to ensure that we have the system kind of change that we need to positively affect our communities from this point forward. One of the things that I'm going to do is make sure that people don't have to pick up the phone, but actually have the ability to walk into their council member's office. I've opened an office right at the heart of Milpa Street.
Your time is up.
Thank you.
I forgot to
Thank you very much. Buenas tardes, good afternoon to everyone present. I greatly appreciate being in front of you as a candidate for District 1. My name is Crucito Herrera Cruz. I was born and raised and educated in the city of Santa Barbara. What I'm here for is running my fourth time as a candidate, not as an incumbent like Mr. Rouse or anybody like that, but as someone that has determination and the political will to create change. The change in district-based elections in the California Voting Rights Act came about and was given a birth when I had to sue the city of Santa Barbara when I was disqualified from participating. That's when I learned the California Voting Rights Act under 14,025 helped us, helped district-based elections, helped the communities with transparency and future accountability with district-based elections. Today we have district-based elections. I'm glad I was one of the plaintiffs, like Ms. Inda was, and like Mr. Aldana was, like Mr. Bañales was, and like Chavez was, to create a change in political disenfranchisement and underservice in the West Side and the East Side districts. It's critical and important on my three-point plan. Work with adult youth education services, basically work on the public infrastructure, and to just be a good city manager on the city's coffers. Thank you very much.
It's an honor and a pleasure to be here tonight. I am not a politician. I worked 16 years at La Cumbre Junior High School, Adams Elementary School, San Marcos High School. My passion, my vision, and my mission is to work for the youth and the elderly. I'm here to represent the third district if I become candidate. For the third district, which is the West Side, a neglected community that has been neglected for many years. And as a candidate, I am planning to have a rent control. I work for Housing Authority for the city of Santa Barbara, so I know what we go through when it comes to housing, to house the homeless, to house families who cannot afford to find a home within the rent. We need to find a way, a system to control the rents, and also clean up the beaches, the parks, and involve the youth. We need to create other forms of life skills for the youth. We're losing too many youth elements, human beings, and we need to create and work as a community to better their lives. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Andrea Martinez-Cohen. I am running for the East Side District 1. I've been a Santa Barbara City resident for about 10 years and a property owner for the last 2 years. And my background is in economic development. I have worked for affordable housing developer and a small business lender for the last 6 years. And before that, I worked for a local nonprofit called Women's Economic Ventures. They do micro lending and also technical assistance and training for small business owners. And so my focus and my passion for running for city council is empowerment of underrepresented individuals and communities. Most of my work has been focused on low-income communities and working with women and minorities to create more opportunities for job creation and increased wealth and helping small businesses revitalize the economy. A couple of the other things that I would like to focus on for the first district is just to make sure that there is outreach and education to tenants, especially Spanish speakers, regarding vital city services. I think a lot of times the information of services that are available is not disseminated properly, bilingually, and the East Side has been a traditionally underrepresented area, and I would like to give those folks a voice and work on empowering and creating opportunities on the East Side. Thank you.
This is a tremendous turnout. Thank you all for being here. If we could only hook Alice up to a couple of cables, I'm sure most of our energy problems would be gone a long time ago. It's nice to see my neighborhood turn out. I've lived down on Las Ondas for 30 years in the house that my wife and I live presently. Our kids went to Washington School and on through Santa Barbara Junior High and High School, so we're relatively familiar with the neighborhood and familiar with how things work here. I've had a business downtown for 32 years, so I've got a little bit of a foot in the private sector and a foot now in the public sector. So I get a little bit of the nuance on how the two systems work. They don't always work together. They don't always work cogently, but I do understand how that goes. I didn't realize until the districts happened that I actually been on the west side for even more than 30 years because I lived on Clearview and I lived on White Avenue, which is all now part of District 2. I'm very interested in continuing the work that I started. I'm very proud of my record in the 4 years that I've been on council, actually five, long story behind that. But to continue the programs that we've started, to continue the continuity, to keep the town safe, to keep it clean, and to keep it fiscally solvent, to keep it sustainable in not only environmental ways, but in fiscal ways as well. So I'd appreciate the vote of the folks in my neighborhood. And I appreciate you all coming out tonight. This is a great sign of things to come on the Mesa. Thank you.
Thank you, Alice and OMNI, for putting together this event. And thank you, everyone who came out tonight. It's a great turnout, and I'm excited to see this level of civic engagement. I bring 25 years of highly relevant quality professional experience to the task. I was a high school teacher, a criminal prosecutor, and a nonprofit leader. Sorry, my iPad's blinking out here. I've got some notes I want to make sure I cover. My experience includes implementing new ideas, solving problems, and encouraging the use of effective resources. I have extensive knowledge of how governments work, having spent over a decade working for the government. Solving the problems we need to solve requires new ideas, requires innovation, requires hard work, and the ability to bring together coalitions. My top priorities as a city council member would be improving public safety, making sure we're using our resources effectively to protect our residents, helping kids succeed by increasing after-school programs, building strong partnerships between City Hall, neighborhood businesses and schools, community groups, and to increase job opportunities for the youth. I'd like to make City Hall more responsive to our needs by using technological innovations, and I'd like to help find a solution to our public infrastructure problem. This is a challenging set of priorities that will require experienced, qualified leadership. I love Santa Barbara. I chose it for my home because of its natural beauty and amazing residents. I was recently engaged to a beautiful woman, and I'm excited about Santa Barbara. Thank you.
Thank you so much for organizing the event tonight and to everyone for coming out. I'm Kathy Murillo, and I've been serving on the Santa Barbara City Council for the last 4 years. It's a public service that I cherish. It's been an honor to serve, to make budget and policy decisions that help our city run smoothly, that provide services to our residents, and to plan for our future. We're saving money again in our reserve accounts, and we're also setting aside money to pay for capital improvement projects. Under my leadership, the city has restored funding for many programs, libraries and parks in particular, and we just opened our new children's library, and I'm especially proud of that. Crime is down under my watch. Gang violence is especially down. And I'm really proud of my West Side neighborhood. I helped revitalize a neighborhood association. It's called the West Side Community Group. They're meeting tonight, in fact, looking at dumping issues, looking at pedestrian safety and parking congestion. That's a huge one on the West Side, maybe in other neighborhoods as well. But I wanted to just close by saying that we're going into the district scenario. I have the experience to serve my home district, but also take care of the entire city. I'm confident I can continue that balanced approach. Thank you very much.
Hi, everybody. I'm Luis Esparza. I'm a native of Santa Barbara. I grew up right down the street, spent my whole life in this district. I attended all the local public schools, mostly in this district. I rushed through college and law school, came back to town to serve my community. Career-wise, the practice of law has been my bread and butter. I also hold a handful of other professional licenses. In terms of public service, I've always been involved with various nonprofits and city advisory groups. Currently, my public service is more behind the scenes with the City College Bond Oversight Committee and the County Grand Jury. Why am I here? Recently starting my own family. It renewed a sense of service to others and increased my attention to all the local issues that affect not only the district, but the city as a whole. Using the political spectrum of left and right, I consider myself middle of the road or socially progressive and fiscally conservative. I agree with the most common sentiment that I heard from constituent feedback when I was walking around gathering signatures that it's time for a change. Thank you.
I probably have the most names on the ballot. I have a K for Kathleen, which is my legal name. Then I have Missy, which has been my nickname for maybe 30, 40 years. Then I have my legal middle name, McSweeney, which was my maiden name, and Zaitsoff, which was my married name. So I got it all in there. I would like to thank everybody. Going through the whole list would be way too long. And I was thinking as Alice was speaking that maybe I should get up, go home, and give her my spot. That would be a really good thing for Alice to do sometime. I am currently involved with the city Coalition Against Gun Violence. I'm on the Fire and Police Commission, which is really wonderful. I really enjoy that. And I'm vice president of the Dingle Ireland sister city for the city of Santa Barbara. I have three main interests, but you've heard them all down the line. Public safety, social justice, which is very big time for me, all of those issues. We talk about youth, we talk about jobs, we talk about housing. Environmental health for all of us, which is very inclusive as well. I pledged 4 years. One of my opponents has had 5 so far, and I feel that I'm running a campaign taking no money and spending no money. I have no one to be beholden to at all, and 4 years will be it, so I don't even have to think about re-election. I believe I can do a lot, though, in 4 years because I was already on the Malibu City Council.
Yes, time's up.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Let's begin with the quick yes-no questions, starting with Mr. Herrera Cruz. Cruise ships. Do you think the benefits outweigh the burdens?
No.
Yes.
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 I have to get a whole sentence in then. No, yes.
Term limits for the city. Do you favor them, yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
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 Do forums like this one give you an effective method to share your message?
Yes.
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 Now we begin the detailed questions, and the first one up is vacation rentals. Candidates will have 1 minute to respond. Watch the 10-second remark. I will cut you off. First up, Mr. Rouse, vacation rentals. What do you see as the core issue or issues with respect to vacation rentals, and what is the long-term solution?
Vacation rentals are in communities, or I should say in zones where they're not permitted currently. Ones that are in zones where they're permitted currently, i.e. not the R1, 2, or 3 zones, but in the R4 zone, is fine. The city itself has made a mistake, I believe, over the last almost a decade of collecting not only transit occupancy tax, but issuing business licenses to vacation rentals in neighborhoods. I believe in neighborhood preservation. I believe in the sanctity of neighborhoods. I believe that when someone buys a house in a single family residence zone, they have the right to expect that their house is surrounded by other residents and not a business.
I hope everyone can hear me. I also agree as a lawyer and as a government lawyer that we need to enforce the law, and the law in Santa Barbara does not allow vacation rentals in these single family resident zones. So if people in these zones want to get together and get the city to change the law, they're welcome to it, but I imagine that's probably not going to happen. So I'm for enforcing the law, not allowing it to take place in these zones. And I think the community has spoken, and the city council is aware of what the community wants and has taken the appropriate action.
Thank you. Earlier, I was chatting with Mr. Navarro, and he told me that there are 7 vacation rentals along his street here on the Mesa. That's way too many. The city council agreed unanimously to forbid them in any zone except R4. And I stand firm with that. And I'm sorry that people are inconvenienced, because the city did allow the business licenses and the collection of the bed tax. So what we did, to be fair, was to give a transition period so people who had invested in them can divest of their business. They bought properties. Just to reiterate what has been said, we do not need commercial activities in a zone where it should be residential purposes only. Thank you.
So the real issue here is enforcement. How do we enforce this kind of situation? I'll give you an example. We have an ordinance that says that we can't renovate garages. Well, guess what? Reality is it still happens. So how do we continue to enforce a structure when we haven't enforced it and we don't have the structure to? That's the real issue. That's the real long-term issue. So we do have to protect the neighborhoods. But in reality, we're not focusing on the fact that, yes, we have vacation rentals, but we also have student rentals that impact the neighborhoods even more. It's difficult to live in an area where you're expecting to be neighborhood and you're surrounded by students that live that leave every semester. So we have to figure out a positive way to enforce these kinds of regulations and make sure that our neighborhoods stay preserved. Thank you.
Thank you. I agree with Inda. The core issue is about enforcement, looking at the zoning ordinance, looking at there is a prohibition already on that type of activity. It's been overlooked, but there's got to be, like Councilwoman Murillo has said, a transitioning period, because there's lucrative businesses happening in the community. Most of the rental, 60% of the rental housing stock is in over the hill here in the flatland in District 3 and in District 1. When you have about maybe 1,200 to 2,000 dwelling units that are renting to communities and that are not, or vacation rentals that are not renting, that takes away from the fabric of Santa Barbians living in the community. That takes away from Santa Barbians consuming in the community. That takes away from Santa Barbians paying sales tax in the community. So in all that venture, we have to look at the zoning ordinance, but at the same time, look at prohibitions against that.
Like I said before, I work for the Housing Authority, and we faced not only vacation rentals, but we faced a lot of international students renting one room in a four-bedroom house. And we are shipping away, or we're sending away, our own local workers to Ventura, to Oxnard, even far south to LA area, because they cannot find anything here. Why? Because we're saturated with so many students, five international schools, two UCSB and City College, plus the vacation rentals. Are we using this property? Are these homeowners paying taxes on these vacation rentals? If they are, what are we doing with those taxes? Are we using it to better our city? Thank you.
I think, yeah, the vacation rental issue is definitely related to the affordable housing issue. When there are so many vacation rentals on the market, it's taking away from long-term rental space that could be used for the working families and people that live in Santa Barbara and that live here permanently. So I do think that the city finally did, backtrack and make the right decision. I think the long-term solution, if, the commercial zones wanted to be expanded to allow more vacation rentals, that would be something to allow people to continue to do VRBOs, in the proper zoning. But I do think that, eliminating the vacation rentals is one step closer to helping solve the affordable housing issue, especially when the, vacancy rate is less than 1%. I think every unit that's available to somebody that lives and works here, that is something for the better. Thank you.
Now, this sounds like a local issue, something that would just affect the Mesa, but it's a bigger issue than that. And the question is, how do we enhance and fund safety improvements along streets such as Cliff Drive? Now, the reason I say it's more than just a local issue is because Cliff Drive allows other areas of Santa Barbara to access the beaches, Douglas Family Preserve, Shoreline Park. It's a community thoroughfare. So the question to Mr. Dominguez is, how do we enhance and fund safety improvements on streets such as Cliff Drive?
So the city needs about $450 million in improvements to its infrastructure. Because of the recession and because of deferred maintenance, we're looking at a pretty big bill. Add in there the new police station. Traffic improvements are expensive, and it's probably gonna end up being a bond measure. There's were proposals on the table already this year at City Council, and there will be proposals next year. And we have dire need for traffic safety improvements. The city of Santa Barbara, out of 104 cities our size statewide, we're second from the bottom in terms of injuries to pedestrians from cars, and we're fourth from the bottom in terms of injuries to bikers from cars. So we do have a traffic safety problem here. We do need to spend the money to fix these problems. I'd like to encourage more people to bike and walk around. The east side is very walkable, so I'd like to get more people out, but first we have to ensure their safety, or at the same time ensure their safety. We have a great master plan for bikes that's being implemented, and I hope you all can get out there and talk about that in your community.
It was a very big deal for the city to take over Highway 225, Cliff Drive. And now we're looking at needing to make improvements. I think that's the purpose of your question. I was supportive of exploring a sales tax initiative. The city council did look at that this year. And we wanted to put it on the ballot just to ask people if they would support it. There might be some other ways. I think people are going to have to pay for it. One of the things that we did was we hired a consultant to do a survey. And it came back that people would have supported paying higher taxes to repair our roads. It's terribly important. And I hope we get there for the whole city and for the Mesa in particular. And the improvements that need to happen on Cliff Drive to make sure that there's more pedestrian safety. I know it's really hard to cross Cliff Drive sometimes as a pedestrian. Thank you.
I, for one, do not believe that we need to further tax our citizenry for things as basic as infrastructure, for example, safety on Cliff Drive. To me, that is something the city should fund. That is a basic necessity. Safety is on Cliff Drive and all of our roads. I go from Mesa Plaza all the way to Loma Alta, which is where the city college is. There isn't a single crosswalk. Today, I'm driving 30 to get here because it's an active time, like 5:30-ish. And there's kids from the city college like walking precariously in the middle of the road. It is the city's responsibility to save money somewhere else and get grants, those grant writers, to pay for this. I don't believe that it's something to tax.
So safety is important, but we can't continue to tax our local residents. We have to explore other options, and bonds may be options, but when I start to hear that infrastructure problems are not only citywide, but also school district-wide, and they're also looking at bond measures, then we're continuing to explore bond measures for things that we need to be more innovative with. And a good example of that is going after federal grants to do infrastructure in our lower socioeconomic areas that would relieve the budget to be able to do other projects within the city. And because now we have districts and we have two socioeconomically challenged areas, we can actually start to explore those options. And we have the city staff to do that. We need to be able to make sure that our city staff is actually doing the things like looking at those kinds of grants to bring in the resources and innovatively look at our budget. Thank you.
I think specifically in how to enhance public infrastructure, the corridor of the Mesa area, it's critical what was said about two candidates up here about creating a whole-wide, overall citywide bond for the public infrastructure. It is correct that we are in positive green economic standings, our sales tax, our property tax at 4% growth, our TOT tax in this last 4 years have grown 10% and then some. We have some in the reserves, but we should be, if we're a tourist-based economy, we should be transferring some of that money into the public infrastructure and also in adult youth services. So the question about, does the benefit outweigh the cost about cruise ships going on? It does. Because if we're buying into a tourism-based economy and that investment doesn't come back to our community, we lose out. We don't benefit anything.
This is not just an issue here up in the Mesa. We had an issue about safety in our city. Milpas accident years ago that killed one of our students, and I said one of our because I was there at one of the high schools. It raised a flag that we needed to create some kind of safety in the east side, but what about the west side? What about up here? What about in the city in general? There is ways to create, to make money, to fund for these issues, and it is involvement, community involvement. The community is eager to participate, but we don't make them part of this community. The community is willing to fundraise, is willing to put up maybe $5 per member of the community. We need to create, and we need to bring the community as one to make changes.
Addressing infrastructure needs involves both, you know, looking at increasing revenues as well as cutting spending. So looking at where there's waste, you know, in some of the city, I think the city does do a good job of, you know, looking at the budget and making sure that things are not being wasted. But I think another way is to increase revenue, and increasing revenue doesn't have to necessarily be a sales tax thing, but I do think that, you know, 60% of the community, per that survey that was mentioned earlier, did agree that they would approve a half cent or a quarter cent sales tax increase in order to fund capital infrastructure needs. So I think that's one way. Also, you know, continuing to stimulate the business economy is what grows our sales tax base and increases revenues that way. So that's another way to focus on how do we find the money. I think it's going to come from many different sources, not just one, but also from cutting spending.
Well, relatively recent policy budgetarily myself and my colleagues put together was we take half of every year's surplus and put that up into capital reserves for this very problem. We did come out and approach the community, vis-a-vis some community meetings regarding infrastructure, regarding potentially a sales tax, some way to raise the revenue. This is a national dialogue. Everybody's gotten behind. We're not alone in our community. This is dialogue going on all over the country. But I was there when Ms. Cardoza talked about the incident on the east side with Sergio Romero when he died. And we did respond as a council. We did go over there. We did take our traffic engineer, and we worked with that community to come up with some solutions. Didn't bring Sergio back, but it was a better situation now than it was then. We did take over Cliff Drive, and we did narrow it down to two lanes, which has been a big improvement. Derek Bailey's been here with you guys. We're working on some more improvements as we speak.
What qualities do you feel are most important to be a member of the Santa Barbara City Council, and how do you rate yourself with respect to those qualities?
I was a journalist before I ran for City Council, and I called myself a government junkie. I loved it. I love reading EIRs. I entertain myself watching government meetings on TV. It's fascinating to me. So I think someone really has to understand municipal government and how it relates regionally and how it connects to the state and federal. And I was a teacher, and so I got to teach young people how to care about civic engagement and what it means to them. We're talking about pedestrian safety. We're talking about how the city banned single-use plastic bags, and that has a huge impact on our oceans and our environment. So that people have to care about the world, civics, politics, and have really good people skills, because building positive relationships is imperative, and I have that skill number 10. Thank you.
I think the most important qualities are leadership, creativity, and being a good listener. How they apply to me, I think I'm rate decently well in at least two of the three categories. I'm working on being a better listener. Leadership, I think, is exhibited by the little political experience I do have, which is mostly in the student government, La Cumbre Junior High and Santa Barbara High. But most importantly, I think the changing times requires creativity, novel approaches, new solutions to lingering problems. And that's what I hope to bring to the council.
I would like to say again that I was already on a Malibu City Council, so I did have my leadership skills honed there. My education is from UCLA. I have a BA in speech and English. I also took classes in mediation and in negotiation recently at Pepperdine University Law School. My family is in public service. My brother is a chief in LA County Sheriff. My son is an engineer for Montecito Fire. That just is in our blood to be public servants, and I'm a policy wonk also. I love EIRs. I'm a teacher, which is a skill, I think, and a youth counselor. And I was Woman of the Year from my 41st Assembly District, which should say I was somewhat of a leader. And the Malibu Times gave me a Citizen of the Year award.
Okay, so the question is qualities. We need to have somebody who's innovative, who can connect to the community that they're serving. We need to have somebody that actually listens and pays attention to all of the diverse communities that they're representing. It's also important to have somebody who has done things for this community and somebody who will continue to do things for their community, because the terms are short and there are many issues to address. We don't have that on council. A clear example of that is how the gang injunction was rolled out and how communities came in hundreds of them asking for something like changing the policy to make sure that we don't have a gang injunction, and we still had to move it forward. We had to go all the way through a legal process. It's important for us to listen, and that's a quality that is very well lost when it comes to all of the infrastructure needs and everything else in our community. Thank you.
I think if I look at an analysis in the budget, page 333, mayors, city council, program number 111141. Can I respond to citizens? Yes. Can I establish and develop programs and policies? Yes. Can I be responsible like candidates here with the city coffers? Correct. Can I evaluate programs and its accomplishments and give an analytical, educated opinion? Yes. Serve on liaisons and be a liaison to community as this district or in the district that I'm running in number one? Yes, I can be that. I think in establishing programs and policies on the budget, I can do those. Those qualities are very important. I think in self-determination, principles that I've learned as a student activist at UCSB and my Mecha days, those are important fundamental principles of self-determination, education, and being involved in the community is critical to create change, positive change. Thank you.
The qualities that I possess to serve as the city council is I've been working for the Santa Barbara School District for 16 years, working with my community, which is the West Side community. I know what the needs are. I'm bilingual. I speak Spanish fully. I also graduated from WEAVE, which is Women's Economic Venture, with honors, and I was a class speaker. I mentored 23 girls through the school year, which is ranges from age 12 through age 18. I coach individuals online through social media when they have issues. I am a leader. I am a leader. I'm the youngest of nine, and I am the one that worked in the strawberry fields back in 1988. But I decided that that was not the life that I wanted to, neither the life that I wanted for my kids. So I became a leader of my own family. Thank you.
I think in order to be able to work effectively on a city council or in any sort of local government entity, you need to work together. Collaboration and working with your fellow other council members is really, really important. Although you might not agree on every issue, you're going to need to come to a consensus at some point down the road, maybe on a future issue. So I think working together and collaborating is a very important quality. In addition, I think having technical experience working with budgets and finance and looking at pro formas and understanding, you know, that the city has, you know, enterprise funds and different revenue sources as well as different expense line items is very important. For a city council member to have a grasp on finance. And lastly, I think just having a fresh perspective and being open to new ideas is very important for a city council member. And I think that I have a number 10 in all of those also.
Well, I'm not really sure how to rate myself. I've been in the seat for 5 years, and I'll leave that up to the folks in this room. I worked with many of you. I've argued with you on some points. We've worked together to do other things. I'm a good citizen. I always read my issues. I vote in every election. I'll probably pick up the paper that you dropped on the ground and put it in the trash can because I believe in this community. I believe that we all have to work together. And to me, that's what's really important. I care about the community. My particular skills and talents are a politician. I have no idea. I really don't. I really can't judge myself. I'll leave that up to you, because that's not what I am. I'm a business guy. I'm a citizen. I'm a dad. Whatever kind of title can I give myself? Anyway, thank you. But I will leave that up to you, but thanks.
Yeah, team player is very important. I've been endorsed by Republicans, Democrats, and Greens. And by Greens, I mean the party, not people who've eaten food that makes them sick. Sense of humor, that's a nice segue into sense of humor. Leadership and strategic planning. I was the executive director of the Legal Aid Foundation. I helped raise money with them, helped resurrect one of their signature fundraisers. I was a program manager for California Rural Legal Assistance, a farm worker advocacy group. I worked on a strategic planning committee for a university. In terms of leadership, I'm actually on the board for Leadership Santa Barbara County, and we have a class every year of about 30 leaders. And hard work is super important because we're doing a lot of great projects and doing a lot of research and analysis and working with committees. I've always been a hard worker. I went to Stanford undergrad and then Berkeley for law school, Bolt Hall. Went to the University of Heidelberg in Germany, and I speak at least three languages. I kind of dabble in one or two more. And challenging complex issues are really important to me. I was a litigator. I've had to... Thank you very much.
The subject is Veronica Meadows. Grassroots organizations are prominent in Santa Barbara. They have been responsible for the acquisition of Shoreline Park and the Douglas Family Preserve. What is your position regarding the acquisition of the Veronica Meadows property that borders Las Positas, and would you or do you approve of the use of Measure B funds for the acquisition?
Well, when I think of Veronica Meadows, I'm glad it is the way it is and that the development of some had in store for it did not occur. The improvements in the area to regarding the parks you mentioned and have been a benefit. Measure B funds, should they be used to acquire Veronica Meadows? I think it'd be an appropriate use of Measure B funds.
I've always believed that a city should grab as much open space land as possible. And when an opportunity arrives, to grasp it. That's why Santa Barbara has so many beautiful parks and so much open space compared to even, well, lots of cities do not have what we have here. And this is where we breathe and this is where we play, and I would be very happy to acquire more land. And I also do not believe in giving any of the city away ever. I don't like that idea. Selling parts of the city, it's not good.
We need to protect our urban forest, and that's what we did. We acquired a space that prohibited development so that we could make sure that we have the kinds of environmental defenses and availability and accessibility for those who can't afford it, who don't have the millions of dollars in the pocket to own land and do all of these wonderful things inside of it. So it is important, and we do need to look at different innovative ways to make sure that we can continue to fund those kinds of opportunities as well.
In answering the question, yes, I would be supportive of acquiring Veronica Meadows in the sense of also using Measure B funds for that.
You have to excuse me, but I am not very familiar with what happened to Veronica Meadows. So I apologize, and that's all I have to say.
I also agree that it's really important to preserve open spaces. You know, as a resident, a user of parks and rec spaces, and especially, you know, the Douglas Preserve and the areas I think that are in really expensive or sought after coastal space, is really important to preserve them, I think, from overdevelopment, to make them accessible to residents that would like to use them for recreational purposes, and to preserve sort of the natural ecosystem that is in those spaces, I think is really, really important. So I would definitely be supportive of that. And I think that the more that they are open to the public and public spaces, the better for all of the residents to enjoy them.
Well, like the Wilcox property, this was a win-win situation. It was a private piece of property slated for development. We were able to, through a long and complicated process, be in this position. I was in favor of Measure Y, not because I was in favor of the development, because I was in favor of a way to prevent all that traffic going into that development down Allen Road. Once again, neighborhood preservation. Now we've come to a situation where with Measure B money, we can restore the creek, which was part of Measure Y, and eventually hopefully get a class one bike lane along that road, which will be fabulous for all people to go along. And we're gonna have that big, nice big roundabout on Cliff and Las Positas. So that's gonna be a fabulous area. Our people on the Mesa have already gotten a system of trails that are laid out. This is gonna be a very walkable, very enjoyable, quasi-urban, but very rural area. So it's a nice addition.
I also am a big proponent of open land. I went to school in Northern California, and Marin County is a leader in California in terms of protecting open space. So I'd love to push for more programs in Santa Barbara that promote open space. My background is in environmental law. I grew up in a really polluted part of Los Angeles. It was also very violent with deadly gang problems. So when I went to law school, I wanted to either work in environmental law or criminal justice. I joined the DA's office where I could do both and try to prosecute some of the environmental dumping. The wait was too long to become an environmental DA. I spent a year there and did domestic violence. I ended up moving to the city attorney's office and running a nuisance abatement program. And a nuisance abatement program is great at fighting environmental hazards. It's also great at fighting crime, because we were able to classify some of the crimes as an environmental issue and clean up the area I worked in. We reduced crime 20-45% amongst different categories. Thank you.
I actively opposed Measure Y. I didn't think that development belonged there, especially it was a giveaway of even a sliver of parkland. Not a good idea. And I do support taking over that property with the Trust for Public Land and using Measure B funds. We're looking at it tomorrow, so I will listen to whatever public testimony there is, but that's the way I'm leaning. And I will say that as an advocate for parks and open space, that I've fought for funding for Bonnet Park to take care of those fields that have been ignored for the longest time on the west side. I funded the new park, the Pocket Park at Bath and Ortega Streets, and also new play equipment at Parque de los Niños in the lower west side, where we really need park resources for our children. Thank you.
The downtown organization, hotel district, and others have / are forming business improvement districts. With the gentrification in certain areas of our community, how would you see your role on the city council with respect to this issue?
Well, I actually attended a few city council meetings, and there's a lot of controversy between different, say, Milpas corridor, business corridor groups. And they're having a timeout until January to get this together, perhaps some consensus. That's what I think I would be good at because of my training at Pepperdine University. We can't have separate groups on one main corridor. Business is very important. That is part of our tourist economy here. And I would want to work on Milpas. Of course, Cliff and Meigs is our District 2 priority, and they seem to be doing well with the merchants and the flags and everything. The big concern is State Street also. That's the really big problem. A lot of empty buildings, a lot of chain stores coming in, a lot of small mom and pops are disappearing. Vacancies, but take care of those.
Business districts are created by businesses to self-assess a value that they all want to pay to brand a specific area to improve business. That's not a difficult thing to swallow, and it's our role for council to make sure that that's actually what's happening, that it's theirs, that it's not something that we're imposing or that we're saying it's too much or too little of. What is important is that we monitor those bids so that they continue to meet the need of our community. In the downtown district, the 400th block of State Street is being completely neglected by the services that are being provided within the bids on the upper part of State Street. Those businesses need to be heard. And that's really the association of bringing people together and making sure that the council person can properly represent them and create that voice.
This is a very important question because it deals with public infrastructure and it deals with the public improvement area of the title in Streets and Highways Code. You could start looking at 36,000 to 36,551. Parking and business improvement districts are critical. We have one in the downtown area. One is being formulated in the Milpas area corridor in our District 1. Eventually, because we have districts, we would want one over here in the Mesa Improvement District in the sense that it creates a tool and mechanism to study, to be able to self-fund in the future to create the promotion of the public infrastructure and was important. I think it promotes economic revitalization. It creates a physical maintenance of the business improvement districts. The downtown organization is a clear example of our RDA monies going in and doing something very positive as an economic engine. We still need to have those implemented in the East Side District, District 1. I'm candidate. I appear first in the pamphlet. Please vote for me. Milpas area, also in the San Roque area. Thank you.
We have business forming groups. Why is it that they're forming groups? Is it the city not listening to all the businesses? Or are they planning to form their own groups because they are trying to improve our city? The reason why they're forming groups is because nobody's listening to them or they are not meeting their needs as businesses. Businesses are important in our city because they bring money, they pay taxes, and how are we using this money? Their taxes to create or to better our community, our city. So if we need to start another group, I think we're gonna need to start a group as of take it to the city and say, well, the businesses are not being listened to, we need to make changes.
In my decade of experience as an economic development professional, a business improvement district is usually a really good thing for the business community. It helps businesses coalesce and come together and have control and a vision and be able to promote their businesses in a certain project area. And it also helps them to have a stronger voice with City Hall. And I think that the role of City Council and the City of Santa Barbara is to help promote economic development activities. And it doesn't necessarily have to be a business improvement district. There's a lot of other tools that can be used to help stimulate businesses like facade improvement programs, just streamlining business permitting processes and getting things through the city departments in a more cohesive way. There's a lot of different ways that you can stimulate business growth, and I think a business improvement district can be a very good one, but it does have to be formed by the businesses. At least 50% of the businesses.
I sit on the board of the downtown organization, which is a BID, and BIDs are formed by businesses for the purposes of co-promotion of that business district. The council is there, not so much the council, the government is there to help facilitate that, we help collect and distribute the funds. We should not be in a position to advocate for or oppose the formation of BID. Neighborhood self-determination in every way is really important. So it's our job to facilitate when asked and get out of the way when not. Thank you.
Regarding bids, having worked as a city attorney in Los Angeles and as a deputy county council here, I've worked with a lot of different agencies that have been formed. And generally, they're very positive, especially where their goal is to improve a district. We all are for improvement, especially when we're in tough economic times. We've had several years of economic recovery, but it's been slow. And we're kind of at a period where we could go back into a recession or depression because we've been growing for quite a while, longer than most natural periods of growth. My role in the council is just to make sure the information is accurately spread and that all the community understands what's happening. So that's where I want to put my emphasis. I'm also very careful about using words like gentrification. It doesn't have a clear economic definition. There's gentrification in the East Side in terms of residential areas because property prices are very high. But in terms of commercial gentrification, I don't see a lot of evidence of that. There's still a lot of vacancies on State Street. Saks just turned into an outlet store. We lost Borders to a Marshall. So I'm very wary of using a term like that.
I understand completely when someone is concerned about gentrification. It's the fear that locals are going to be pushed out, that we're going to focus too much on tourists rather than locals. There is a way to do business improvement districts that doesn't lead to gentrification. How do you make improvements without pushing out, making everything way too expensive and pushing people out? Urban planners have figured that out. But what we really need to encourage whenever someone wants to do a business improvement district is a painstaking community process. Lots of meetings, meetings until your head's ready to burst, so that everybody has had their say, so that everybody is engaged in the planning. You ask the businesses, what do you need? What do you want? And then that's where you start. You don't make up an idea and then try to push it on people and push an assessment on them. If they're going to pay an assessment, you have to make sure that they're going to get something for it. And really quick, the Westside Community Group has a business coalition. We're planning a tamale festival annually in March. Thank you.
My law office for the past decade or so has been in the downtown area where I cut checks on a quarterly basis or annual basis for the downtown organization and believe the parking improvement district. And I have mixed feelings about these private organizations who have the power to assess and use the city PO box to collect the funds and city personnel to distribute. Other than steam washing the sidewalks and perhaps some subsidized parking, polishing a golden fire hydrant downtown, I'm not quite sure what stimulation of business has been occurring that past decade or so, other than the occasional mixer. So I think the role of the council is to assure if these funds are going through city channels, that the funds are prudently being spent, and also to see if the city itself is in a better position to stimulate business, or people like Alice who have done a great job on the Mesa without the need of an assessment.
It's a two-part question. Make sure you answer both parts. What have you accomplished of which you are most proud? What have you accomplished of which you are least proud? And in hindsight, how would you do it differently? So what did you learn? So most, least, and what would you do different?
Well, I don't want to go on and on and on about all the stuff I've accomplished that I feel very proud of. I could tell you that I'm a product of the community. I was born and raised in the district where I'm running, and I'm representing the community now with all of the active projects I'm involved with. I'm very proud of getting community together so that they could address the need of a cleanup of a creek on the east side that hasn't been addressed and has been neglected. That's something that I'm proud of. Maybe something that I'm not proud of is making sure that I have the ability to engage all of our community in dialogue that's positive, and making sure that I have the ability to respond to our community within all of the diversities. So what do I do to address that? Is I constantly reevaluate what I do. And I constantly connect with the community and ask, what is it that you need me to do differently? I'm not here running and then I'm gonna disappear. I continue to work with my community, whether I'm running or not, and it's something that I'm proud of. Thank you.
I guess I'll confess, I'm here at the rectory. Father Ludo, where are you? Don't estas. Well, what I'm least proud of, I guess, is realizing that I lived in a materialistic world when I was young, wanting all those things before me, being expelled from Santa Barbara High School for breaking into my own high school as a senior and not graduating and walking with my class. That's the least humbling story that I have. But that showed me incarceration. That showed me people locked up. Those showed me stories of people doing 20 years sleeved out. Understanding their stories. Until I was 2021, it really gave me a sense of hope coming out of that despair between 18 and 20, 21. It gave me the opportunity to be self-educated here at Santa Barbara City College, UCSB in political science, some Santa Barbara College of Law, and I'll finish my PhD at UCSB. I'll be writing a book on El Plan de Santa Barbara. Thanks to that young man over there, Dr. Gilbert Robledo. Thank you, sir. We're gonna have it done. This is what my passion, education is the key.
Thank you.
That's why I'm here, education.
What have I accomplished? Well, coming from a Texan's mother and a Mexican father, I immigrated to the States, not by choice, when I was 16 years old. I worked in the strawberry fields, like I mentioned. I went to high school. I graduated from Dos Pueblos High School. After that, I got married very young. I had two sons, which I'm very proud, 25 and 20 years old. I took care of my mother until she passed, and I have worked for the community, for the Westside community, for the last 16 years. Those are accomplishments that I feel proud of. I work for the community, with the community. I'm not here to run for city council for myself or by myself or to benefit myself. It's to benefit my community. That's my passion. That's my mission, and that is my vision. Thank you.
I think the accomplishment that I would be most proud of is just basically dedicating my career to helping other people. It's so rewarding when you know that you have made a difference in somebody else's life. And I feel that there's so many different business owners and families that I have worked with throughout the years that I know that I've made a difference. They've told me that I made a difference. And I think the only thing that I regret at night sometimes is that I couldn't do more. You know, you want to do everything. You want to work as hard as you can, you know, for yourself and for everybody. And so I think one of the ways, you know, that you can overcome that, or one way to fix that, is to maybe be more focused, you know, to take it one thing at a time that you can do and affect the change that you have the power to do, and to sort of let go of the rest and know that you can't be all things to all people at all times, but you just try your hardest to help as many people along the way as you can.
Well, it looks like my wife picked a perfect time to leave. I think what I can say I'm most proud of, and I'll put this in the context of council, I'm most proud of the ability that I brought forward an idea to do a community service officer program to help extend our presence on State Street, or authoritative presence, without having to spend the kind of financial resources it takes to put full uniform officers out there. I guess the thing I'm least proud of is my inability to move the dialogue forward. I do like talking about policy. I actually do like talking about politics, and it's almost impossible to do without it becoming almost a religious exercise. So I think it's my failing in that bothers me the most.
I'm most proud of my record of public service. When I was in high school, I got the award for most public service hours in my service club. I was then elected to their board of trustees, which was an international board, so I went around the country and promoted public service. I inherited this trait from my grandmother, who was in charge of her church's social club, but it wasn't social, it was really a service club. They went around all the seniors in this town, made sure they had enough food, made sure they had clothing, and they would just sit and visit when that was all that was required. I have had the benefit and the luck to serve a lot of underprivileged people, both at CRLA, where I did farm worker advocacy, and then at Legal Aid Foundation, where we served about 500 people a year. Before that, I was a high school teacher, and I went to Prague and worked in Prague the year the wall came down to try to bring over Westerners to shore up their very fledgling, fragile democracy. I'm least proud that I only have one life to give to my country, and there's always more I really want to do, and just running this campaign, I've had to give up a lot of the nonprofit work.
Now that I'm running in a district scenario, people are asking me, what have you done for the West Side? Well, I have a long list. I'll just mention a couple. I'm the city's liaison to the MTD bus agency. I secured good bus service for my community, really important. Also, I'm on the Community Action Commission board, made sure that our preschool on the Lower West had Head Start money, looking out for my West Siders. But I've done a lot for the East Side as well. I held office hours at the East Side Library. I considered myself the East Side representative for those years that I've been on this council. When the people in Oak Park were upset about the helicopters at Cottage Hospital, I was the only council member who went to their big forum. I'm proud of that. I have looked out for this entire city. But I'm able to say, look, here's my long list of West Side accomplishments. And I'm happy to pass them out if anybody's interested. Thank you so much.
Although it's personal, I think this is an easy one for me, because as previously mentioned, and as many parents here can attest, my proudest accomplishment is becoming a father. I'll elaborate on that. I think I just hope to build on the foundation that was provided for me by my parents. And one of the main lessons I've received is to try to make the next generation better than the previous. Well, that can carry over to the political realm as well. Parenthood, like politics, is somewhat new to me, but I'm up to the challenge. The second part of the question, what I'm least proud of, is sometimes required by my job as an attorney, is requiring to take an adversarial role to go on the attack. And to step away from that and to learn and improve is what I hope to bring to the council as a member.
I believe I'm most proud of my accomplishment of raising 5 children and now helping, helping to raise 2 little District 2 grandchildren, believe it or not. I'm also very proud of helping other people's children throughout my life. I used to work in Camarillo at the youth prison run by the state of California as a substitute teacher for 3 years. I'm with Kathy's pro-youth movement. I worked for Santa Barbara County Probation Department at our extinguished juvenile hall as a youth counselor and also as an institutional officer. I feel as well as a teacher, guest teacher at Notre Dame and at Carpentria, that again, I'm helping other people's children. I have failed, I think, in being endlessly hopeful. That is a very bad quality. For example, what I'm doing right now.
With the already overwhelming stress on the city's infrastructure, how do you justify high density building? And what is your position on growth/development?
When we're creating policy within the city that deals with high density, the housing element within the city of Santa Barbara, we have to look at the development that's happening in District 3 and District 1. A lot of condominiums, a lot of buildings are going up. Santa Barbara has been recognized that we have been built out, and we have to build equitably, reasonably, up in the city of Santa Barbara. Most of the urban development that's happening is happening in District 1 and in District 3. So we have to be critical of the policies. It's about parking, about health and safety concerns. We talk about public services. We talk about youth education. We talk about the infrastructures, the parks, and having a good place to live, a safe place to live, and investing in that. I think in growth and development, it's critical that we look at a housing development program and the economic development program that's now supposed to be administered by the city council. I think that's critical to take leadership.
I think that we need to address the issue of housing again. Like Crucito said, we have built to the sides, but nothing, you know, and to the high ceilings. We need to build more up because the housing need is extremely high. We do have the land. We do have old empty lots that we can use to build up. Housing Authority has been a number one architect, if I could say a teacher, to many other builders and many other architectures from other states. They have come and ask for advice on how to build up because Housing Authority, it's very well known for their architecture and well developed in small pieces of land. So we do need to build up to create more housing and affordable housing for our residents.
I think that, you know, the AUD program was designed to help address the needs of the affordable housing where appropriate. I think there's been some different persons of the city that have been identified of where this development would be appropriate and designated. I do think that the issue of neighborhood compatibility is always important. You know, a lot of neighbors don't want to see, you know, multifamily housing when it's a single family neighborhood. The reality is though that we need to do something to address the affordable housing need, and the AUD program I think is a well-designed program that can help address it. There does need to be more coordination, I think, between Planning Commission and the Architectural Review Board as far as the guidelines and helping to better educate the developers and architects about what is going to be compatible and what is going to be able to get passed and through the city and that will be conforming with the neighborhood. I think that would help to make the program more efficient.
Well, the AUD program was in fact designed to help alleviate the affordable housing problem, and it has been quote unquote an experiment, either 250 units or 8 years. And like most planning overlays, like a Sims game you might play with your kids, there are things that work in theory, things don't work in practice. And one of the things that doesn't work in practice is neighborhood compatibility all the time. We need parking overlays to be scrutinized every time because adjacent neighborhoods get victimized by over-densification. 300 or 400 square feet is not quality of life for people. And I think our job housing imbalance really needs jobs, not the next hotel or restaurant job. It needs the kind of jobs that Sonos brought in, the kind of jobs that Deckers provides. We need to be more proactive in bringing in real corporations with real jobs and higher wages.
I have experience structuring complex solutions as an attorney, and this is just one of these examples where you have to create a win-win out of a difficult situation. In the past, we saw people try to polarize the environment versus the economy. When we had Measure P, I was fighting for Measure P because I wanted oil to be regulated. I wanted our kids to be safe. I didn't want oil to be flowing freely around our city and causing injuries. What you have to do in this situation is balance neighborhood tensions. And that's the toughest part of this job. You're going to lose some friends if you stick to your guns and try to find a pathway where everyone's happy because some people just won't agree with your solution. For example, with crime, I'm tough on crime, but I also realize there are issues with the criminal justice system. I have a few family members who were in prison who sentences were just too long given the acts that they took. So really this job is about balance. In this particular case, this law came into effect in 2011. It's nearly played its course out, so we'll see what the impacts are and we'll redesign the law.
In terms of the average unit size density incentive program, only two projects have been approved so far and neither has been built. So not one unit has been built yet under this housing program. So we don't know yet the impacts of it. But we do need well-designed, well-planned housing along transportation corridors if we're going to build something dense enough to be meaningful for the project developer and to provide housing for people. Are you ready to tell somebody, no, your son or daughter doesn't have a place in Santa Barbara anymore? I mean, those are the tough tensions that we're coming up against. It's traffic capacity, parking capacity, and water supply are all the things that are at tension there. And to me, on the west side, parking is a huge issue. Thank you.
I think the city has taken great strides to tackle this reoccurring issue. I'm reluctant to call it a problem because it's a byproduct of being in a very desirable place to live. The city population seems to not grow too much, but there's always a need for more affordable housing. The AUD ordinance or program, I think it's a good approach. It appears to be about to be utilized by developers who are seeking the higher density as opposed to medium density units. Looking at the map, there seem to be in appropriate areas, but how to deal with it going forward, perhaps a similar program or ordinance, but limited only to medium density as opposed to high density, to mitigate some of the concerns regarding natural resources such as water, and also to think forward about the upcoming changes. Parking's a common issue, but 5 to 10 years, there might be a lot of driverless cars around.
One of the reasons Malibu Incorporated, and I was on the first council, was because of density issues. We did not want to be sewered from one end to the other to induce growth. I have always been against high density. I've always been against large projects that are not necessary, like this one that I just heard the Planning Commission talk about in concept only, not even applied for yet, at Garden and Yanonali. A site like this would be big enough, I think, if the city could get the funding somehow to try to buy out this developer. That might be more housing for us. I also believe in making it easy for second units in large backyards, granny units. It was very good instead of high density. And I know that everybody cringes when you hear Section 8, but that eliminates putting a lot of low-income people in a dense situation. Have you been to Punta Gorda lately to see
this,
those?
This site's off.
So we actually won't receive the outcome of this project of AUD until we actually get to evaluate how it's working. What we do need to do is address the actual housing issues that we have. We have dense housing, especially on the east side and on the west side. And that's a reality. Not only do we have homes that are divided up into three or four sections so that people can live and afford to live here. So what do we do about it? We study issues like SLRI, which are coming up to council, to look at how do we partner with the environment and how do we make things safe enough so that people can continue to function. We also need to make sure that we address the fact that most of our local families have to move outside of the city because they can't afford it. Affordability is something that we need to actually start to focus on. These kinds of projects are important and we need to monitor them, but we need to get back to the facts of what actually is happening in our neighborhoods. Thank you.
With the new system of individual district representation, how would you work together with other members of the council for the good of all while pursuing the needs of your district in the face of limited funding?
I have been a team player. I work for the school district. I work with the budget. I was able to see the funds and allocate the funds accordingly and as needed for one school. I was also in charge of 32 teachers, as well as the staff, the supportive staff. So I know how to work as a team. I also know how to read budget. I also know how to budget and work in collaboration with others. I will focus on my district, see the needs of my district, as well take it to the city and work together as a team. District 3 is very important, and like I said before, it's been neglected for so many years. Bring the community together, make them participate in the decisions of the budget taking.
Thank you, Ms.
So I think that there's a lot of overlapping issues that are very specific to certain districts, but also that are important to citywide issues. You know, I think a lot of public safety issues, you know, all neighborhoods are looking at improving street lighting and crosswalks at intersections, and looking at, you know, littering and trash dumping issues, and all of those things are places, are issues that you could put in any part of the city. So part of being a council member that represents your district is knowing the specific nuances of your neighborhood and the specific needs, but also being able to look at what are some things that are happening in your neighborhood that are happening citywide that could maybe be addressed with a more, you know, comprehensive plan from the city. So I think while you have your district in mind and you are dedicated to helping the district receive the improvements and the services that they deserve, you're also going to be able to focus on citywide issues that are affecting not only your district, but all residents.
So the balkanization of the city vis-a-vis the district election system has always been a big concern. I wasn't in favor of districts. You guys didn't get to choose it, but here we are, we have districts now. But still, we have one fire department, one police department, and one budget to deal with. If somebody calls me from San Roque, I'm going to respond. If somebody calls me on the east side, I'm still going to respond, just like I do the lady at Mesa Lane that always wants those eucalyptus trees trimmed. That's important. It's important that all six of us, plus the mayor, still understand that it's one city, one budget, and we do work as a team. Yes, we'll come into our neighborhood meetings, we'll listen to our neighborhoods, but we still will be one city, and I hope that whoever gets elected truly understands that we're still going to be one city with one set of unified issues.
Randy mentioned balkanization. Well, I worked with Yugoslavia when I was a member of the UN's International Criminal Tribunal, and I had to work with some very powerful countervailing forces in a very tight area with Serbia, Croatia, Slovenia. So if I had success there, I can definitely have success here. I don't think we're going to have any problem with balkanization. I think Santa Barbarans are one Santa Barbara. We're all for this great community. People are not going to have any issues. Good ideas stand on their own two legs. Good budgeting stands on its own two legs. My father was a CPA, and so I did bookkeeping for him growing up, learned how to work the 9-key. And I think it's just a matter of getting our heads all aligned and working in the same direction for a greater community. I don't anticipate any problems.
Most decisions made by the city council are unanimous, 95-97% of the time. The press like to write about the issues that we have disagreements about or that are controversial. So maybe it seems like we're always fighting about something. The West Side has half as many registered voters as the Riviera. And what that tells me is that we need to register more voters on the West Side, because voting power equals political power. I need help to represent the West Side from my neighbors, from the people who live on the West Side, to be organized. And that's why we got going our West Side community group, which had a meeting tonight about dumping and other issues, to get city services and Marburg to come take away the mattresses and the TVs. But it's all about integrity. I disagree with Frank Hotchkiss on a whole bunch of things. But at the end of the day, we're walking to the parking lot. Good night, Kathy. Good night, Frank. It's how you treat people, and it's how you interact
Good night,
with them.
Maria.
Thank you, Steve.
The new election format, although the route was a bit unpleasant and unfortunate, I think is a more direct form of democracy. I think the Mesa, or District 2, is especially well situated to take advantage of the opportunity to have needs that are dear to the heart of the district residents put forward onto the city council agenda. So as a District 2 representative, first and foremost, I would represent the constituents, the people who put you in office, the voters. Secondly, I think, although it's a surprise to hear that most of the decisions are unanimous, I think there is a sort of polarization of the council, and I would hope to bring a sense of balance to that, as well as civility, to assure that continue the good work.
I have full confidence that I could work with the other members and the mayor. Most of the issues will affect the entire city. The 101, the water shortage, the wastewater treatment plant, all of these things, the recycling water, housing issues, every type of infrastructure, small businesses, homeless problem. I think we should get involved, all of us, in the education, because the students did not test very well with the new system. And then there's the specifics for each district, which we will all listen to each other's district's concerns. And we have our waterfront in District 2. We have a need for a post office of some sort. We have our new trail program, $300,000 possible grant for Douglas. And everyone will work together. I wasn't in favor of districts because I thought it took your 5 votes away.
Ms. Zaitsov, thank you.
So, as one of the people who actually created this new system, I have to tell you that there's a lot of work to be done. We have to transition our city into a district-based structure. What does that mean? That means appointing commissions and committees by district so that our council members won't balkanize a system, so that you have equal voice and representation coming through all of the commissions and the committees. That's important, and it still needs to happen. There are other things that we need to do within our structure, citywide structure, to really start to focus in on districts. And that's taking responsibility and also taking advantage of certain things. Like, we can have a council person who can open an office within their district and coordinate services so that the community can come in and address issues and get other mental health services and county services to coordinate together, and at the same time start balancing out what they need for the city at large.
I think it's critical that we're at a new little policy democracy here in the city of Santa Barbara under the California Voting Rights Act. We have a population, about 50% population Mexican American, Latinos, Hispanics, Americans, Americanos. We got to say Americanos and integrate our community as such, because then that will be a stronger community, will be a healthier community, will be a more vibrant community, an inclusive community. As Americanos, in District 1 and in District 2, there's been an underrepresentation. The California Voting Rights Act will give political equity to those that didn't have a voice in the past. But what that translates to all districts is that we got to work with our Mesa district, because what we have in common is the ecology of the oceanfront. We border our borders there. So we would work in conjunction with District 2. We would work in conjunction with District 3. We would work in conjunctions when implemented in 2017, District 4, 5, and 6. It's important. We're still one community, but now we have accountability and transparency in our polity.
Do you support or do you not support raising the minimum wage to $15 per hour? And what is your reason for or against?
In general, I do support an increase in the minimum wage. I think that when housing costs are going up and after the recession, the economy has been improving, but wages have not increased. Two-thirds of all minimum wage earners are women. And I think that it's important to create wage equality for women, but also, you know, the minimum wage is what affects our lowest income working families, you know, working two or three jobs with kids. These are the people that are really going to benefit the most from the minimum wage increase. And from a business perspective, a small business perspective, and having worked with a lot of small businesses, a lot of people say it's a job killer, right? People aren't going to hire anybody if the minimum wage goes up. I do think the details are yet to be seen about how the minimum wage rolls out and in what year, you know, it's supposed to phase up to 15, you know, by 2018 or something like that. But a more competitive job market is a winner for small businesses. They get more engaged, efficient workers, and it doesn't have to be a job killer.
Well, as someone who's been in business for over 30 years, I have some experience with minimum wage and four raises in minimum wage. It's not something government should be necessarily involved in. When I sell a product at market price. When the cost of making that product comes to market accelerates beyond what I can sell this for, that job goes away. I don't necessarily still have a market for this product. So when I talk about having people who work in the parking lots as kiosk operators say, well, are those real jobs? They are jobs. But those will go away in the $15 minimum wage. You cannot create the revenue out of nowhere to pay this new wage. It has to come from somewhere. Where does it come from? Are we going to provide that in the government? I don't think so. So what's important is that businesses compete for employees and the wages go up because businesses make the wages go up, not because this of government fiat.
I think it's very perilous to commit to a public policy without having a very rigorous study, and we haven't studied this policy. I think we should take a close look at raising the minimum wage. The state is raising the minimum wage statewide in 2016 to $10. Seattle and San Francisco have raised the minimum wage to $15, but we're not Seattle and we're not San Francisco. When we get Amazon and Starbucks and Microsoft to move down here from Seattle, let's raise the minimum wage because you have a high wage base of people who can spend that money in the restaurants and the hotels to pay those wages. When Facebook, Apple, and Google move down here from San Francisco, then we can raise the minimum wage surely to $15. I'm gonna do my best to encourage those companies to come down here. I spent 7 years in Silicon Valley going to college and law school, and I've got some great alumni connections. So I'd like to get some of those venture capitalists down here. But until we study it, I think it's folly to jump on a bandwagon.
Yes, I do support an increase in the minimum wage. The proposal is not written yet. I really would like to get my hands on it. I understand it's going to be modeled after the Los Angeles or San Francisco proposal where an increase is phased in over time. I'd like to analyze how it will impact small businesses as well as nonprofits. But yes, in concept, I do support it. Thank you.
I'll preface it with a couple comments which will help explain my general support. I think it is for government to act, but it's probably the federal to state government to better address those types of issues that have such a blanket effect on labor. But to the extent that they haven't acted, which they haven't, and which is one of the reservations I have, is from going from $10 to $15, it's quite a big jump percentage-wise. Those types of changes should take effect more incremental, more gradually, and more constantly, and we wouldn't be in a position of having to make such a drastic increase. But it probably needs to be done because the city living wage, for example, provides roughly a half of a family budget that's required to even survive in a town like this. And the working people deserve it.
Well, I have, of course, not read the exact proposal, as no one has. But I'm willing to stick myself out here and say, in a beautiful city of Santa Barbara, $15 an hour is not an exorbitant minimum wage. And I truly believe that we should all work towards getting that, especially with the comment made about the females. A lot of single females don't even have another half to help them. And I do believe that we should make that work, and I don't think it should take years to go up to 15. I will do it as soon as possible. And I do believe that government has those rights.
The devil is in the details, somebody said not too long ago. And we do have to make sure that we look at the ordinance when it actually does come and when the proposal is in place that we actually spent some time studying it. I definitely support increasing the minimum wage and developing it and taking actual part in looking at the document and creating the document. But we also have to focus on education, folks. In my district, 50% of the kids don't graduate with a diploma. Only 8% of the community actually has anything higher than a BA. It's even worse on the west side. So there's definitely some downfalls that we need to address. And in order to do that, that takes working council with school districts to make sure that our kids are effectively going on to college and able to actually sustain their families as they grow up.
We have to understand minimum wage is a national movement. It's statewide movements. It could be a local movement. It's important. I am supportive of raising the minimum wage. If our economy is tourist-based and service industry in its majority aspects of employment within the city structure, I think we should empower those at the economic triangle to give them economic distribution, to give them a higher living standard. The living standard in Santa Barbara is a little ridiculous in the sense of people, constituents have talked about rent control, in the sense of being able to bring a little bit more money into their pockets, which is critical. It's a part of the aspects of the capitalism of that we have to correct, but also empower the working class. So I am supportive of that because it would create a better living standard. It would create better access to health to the families. It would probably be the opportunity of getting your educational books in our community and District 1. So those are critical things happening in our community.
I do support the minimum wage to go up to $15 an hour. The reason being is because parents have 2 to 3 jobs. They have to have 2 to 3 jobs to support a family of three. When it comes to trying to find a rental unit, and I go back to that, the rent for a one-bedroom apartment is $2,100 for a one-bedroom apartment. No families can afford $2,100 for one bedroom if they have a family of three. So what do? They combine two families in one-bedroom apartment. In that time that they should spend with their family, they're spending it working 2 to 3 jobs to pay the $2,100 for one-bedroom apartment. So it's pretty sad. We do need to increase the $15 minimum wage.
It's a two-part question. Water. Given the ongoing drought, what efforts should be taken to augment our water supply? And how do you feel about the city taking on partners like Montecito and Carpinteria to help fund, operate, and maintain the rejuvenated desalination plant? And that is for Mr. Rouse.
As you know, we've currently approved the restarting the desal plant. We're going into talks. We've approved the idea of going to talks with Montecito and other neighboring agencies. That's not the entire answer. We can produce in our initial stage 3,000 acre feet. We need about anywhere between 12 to 14,000 acre feet a year to sustain our normal flow of water. So we've come to a new era. We have to know that we are going to live differently than we've lived all these years. The idea that we can spend and use water the way we have over all the years is going to change. Our lifestyles have changed. The desal plant is going to be the one thing we can count on in terms of having at least the amount of water we need to either recharge the groundwater tables to give us basic health and human services that we need with water. But we are going to have to change, and our policies are going to have to reflect that.
I think a partnership is a great idea. Share some of the costs, some of the very high capital infrastructure costs of reviving this desal plant. We have to be very concerned about our water supply. It may not rain for another 4 years. We have a lot of pollution entering into our water supply, both from the agricultural industry and the petroleum industry. So you're never sure how that's going to play out. We need to have more permitting, more studies. There are wellpoint injection locations in the North County where they're finding more and more pollution from the steam injection fracking that's going on up there. So these are things we have to be concerned about. So we want to make sure that we have a guaranteed water supply for the city.
The city has a diverse portfolio of water sources, groundwater. We also purchase it from other parts of the state. I did agree to open conversations with Montecito Water District for the purposes of sharing the water and sharing the cost. I did want to make it clear that it's our plant, and if we need the water, I don't want to share it. But global climate disruption means, according to the scientists, that we will have longer periods of drought and longer periods of heavy rain. The way to go for our long-term planning is to capture that rainwater. We have to be careful to let some go for the fish. We have to follow all the rules. You can't just dam up a creek. But there are ways to capture rainwater, and we need to start planning for that now. Thank you.
I think the residents deserve credit here. The percentage drop in use by the average city customer is substantial, is impressive, and we can all do more. I myself have chosen to lead by example. I've installed a rain barrel collection system with the gutters. Took it out, put in drought-resistant landscaping. For those that still have lawns, I encourage you to contact the city and take advantage of the rebate that they have to rip out the lawns and put in drought-resistant landscaping. So I think those things need to be built upon. With regards to the desal plant, it's pricey. I would like to see some solar or some other things mitigate the energy intensiveness of it. If the city finds itself in a position where it's on the verge of being mothballed or we have some unexpected rain, I would be more open to then partnering with the other cities or sharing.
I think there are some areas we haven't really considered. I think some of the recycled from the wastewater plant could be made in some way available to the rest of us. There's the gray water systems. They're expensive, but they're using your own laundry, not your toilet water. And the city can provide incentives for that, like they have for the landscaping. I think maybe we'll have another stage four coming up soon for the drought. I am very against giving water service agreements to new development when we all have gold grass at home. There comes a time, I think Goleta's already done it. You have to stop giving new buildings and new homes even water when we don't have any. And the desal is only 25% of our needed water. We need to up that.
Yes, the desalination plant is not going to give us all the water we need. It's our responsibility as council members to look at the impacts on our environment. If we're going to create a desal plant that flushes out extra salt into our water, we have to ask ourselves how we're going to impact our environment when there are other 5 plants in the state of California. We also should have looked at creating a microgrid that would have amped up solar power energy. Instead, we chose to support Southern California Edison in developing and amping up a peaker plant next to Elwood Elementary School, where most of our Ivy families attend. It's our right to protect our water sources, but it's definitely our responsibility on council to make sure that we have everything in place to make sure that our environment is still thriving for our youth in the future.
It's critically important as a public steward or a public representative to be responsible for land, water, air, and the people of its populace, of its polity. What's critical about water is that it affects us all. It gives us all life. The desalination plant is one important aspect of it. Yes, it might have cost enough, but we needed that long time ago. I think in creating outreach and water conservation amongst its populace, homeowners, renters, the school systems is critical. Like Mr. Esparza said, we've done great as a citizenry to reclaim our waters when we're brushing the teeth, put in a bucket, use it for the flowers. So these things are very critical because it goes to preserving water. I think in reclaimed water and the wastewater management is critical. We need more funding. If you look at the budget on page 523 to 554, it deals everything with water. So in providing more budget allotments to that program is important.
I do believe that we do need to find partnership with other maybe cities, states, to bring water. It's possible. We do it in Mexico all the time, where we go and use the buckets, and we hire the big trucks to bring water from one city to another. And I think that it will be possible and it will be cost effective. As well, we need to educate the community as of how to recycle the water that we do use to wash our dishes, do our laundry, recycle that and use it again. So it is important to get educated on the usage of water and recycle that. The plant, it's a very important, and it is possible we can budget accordingly, not spending $50 million on that, because it's a very large number, $50 million in water. Thank you.
Yeah, so water is obviously a huge issue, especially, you know, in the midst of this ongoing drought and all of the climate change. I think that, you know, the desalination plant and partnerships with other cities would help to bring down the costs and could make, you know, an economies of scale type of situation to increase the outcome of or the amount of water that the plant could produce. As well, though, I think that there's other different interesting plans that are going on. You know, Cambria did a new plant where they're using brackish water. Also, people have mentioned that wastewater recycling. I think that probably would be the number one thing that we should be looking into more than the desalination plant. There's about 6 million gallons of water that's cleaned and treated, not up to potable all the way, but it has been treated that gets pushed back into the ocean every day. And if we could just clean that water all the way up to potable, there would be a much bigger source of water there than I think the desal plant could ever produce.
That's the last question. This concludes the Mesa Candidates Forum for 2015. I think we all owe the candidates a big round of applause. They've done a great job.